Boasting excluded, pride I abase, I'm only a sinner. By grace, only a sinner, saved by grace. Only a sinner, saved by grace. This is my story, to God be the glory. I'm only a sinner, saved by grace. Once I was foolish and sin ruled my heart, from God to depart. Jesus hath found me, happy my case. I now am a sinner, saved by grace. Only a sinner, saved by grace. Only a sinner, saved by grace. This is my story, to God be the glory. I'm only a sinner, saved by grace. On that last supper, a sinner, his heart overflows, loving his Savior to tell what he knows. Once more to tell it, I'm only a sinner, saved by grace. Only a sinner, saved by grace. Only a sinner, saved by grace. This is my story, to God be the glory. I'm only a sinner, saved by grace.
All right, good singing tonight. Aren't you glad you can sing that? We're all sinners, but there's some sinners saved by grace. And I'm glad that I heard the gospel and the good news that Jesus saves. And good singing tonight. Good to see you in church on Wednesday night. Let's bow together and pray, shall we? Heavenly Father, we bow before you for the beginning of this service, Lord, and we thank you that we're sinners saved by your grace. It's by grace we are saved through faith, that not of ourselves, it is a gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. We love you tonight, Lord. We're thankful for the opportunity to gather together here. Thank you for each one that's made their way here this evening, Lord. Made the effort to come and be together here in the house of God. And, Lord, the only promise we're holding on to is the fact you said you'd be here if we gather together tonight. We're excited about that, and we look forward to what you're going to do in each of our hearts and lives this evening. So control the service, and we pray that you'll have preeminence in everything tonight, that you'll be lifted up, and as you're lifted up, you'll draw all of us closer to you. So use the service to that end, please. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right, you may be seated.
285 in your hymnal, 285. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. 285, on that first together. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arm. I'm leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace. Leaning on the everlasting arm, I'm leaning on Jesus Christ, my Savior. perish? This evening's missionary message is from Rodney and Kathy Fitzsimmons, missionaries to Haiti. Dear friends in Christ, we are honored to share the following update with our partners in ministry. Focused on a local church, in 2003, we started the Berean Baptist Church in the village of DeFontes. The pastor of this new work, St. Hubert Satou, was saved in our first church in the village of Duvon. In 1986, he made a profession of faith earlier, but came to me one evening before the service and confessed he was a lost church member. After trusting Christ for salvation, he completed both levels of study in our Bible school and then approached me about starting work in DeFontes. Over the past 12 years, the Lord has blessed with many souls saved. Please pray for this pastor and his family, who face continual opposition from many in this village who are involved in voodooism. They often also struggle with poor health. New work in Innery. Lord willing, in October, we'll be starting a new work in this town, working with a graduate of our Bible school. Please pray for this man and this new church plant. Ministry at Platon. In June, we're able to complete the purchase of the land for this new work and plan to help them build a structure this fall. The funds have already been provided for this construction. Berean Baptist Bible School. Next month we'll begin a new trimester in the Bible school and are expecting 40 to 50 new students. Please pray for power-filled teachers and students with hungry hearts to be taught the truth of God's Word. Summer furlough. During the summer, we will have traveled to 7 states updating 21 supporting churches on the work in Haiti. We thank the Lord for blessed service and traveling mercies. Please pray for the remaining meetings and for our return to the field on September 23rd. Special prayer. In June, we requested prayer for Pastor Steve Rich, who was undergoing treatments for cancer. The treatments are now over, but the results of effectiveness will not be known until October. Please continue to pray for him, his family, and the church. We rejoice for so many who are interested in ministry through prayer and financial support. In his service, Rodney and Kathy.
Amen. Always a good report from the Fitzsimmons and the good work that the Lord's doing with them there in Haiti, and doing a great job, and we appreciate that. Get your prayer guide out, would you? Anybody need one tonight? Put your hand up. The usher will get you one right down front here. Brother Paul Label, Brother Scotty needs one. Anybody else? Everybody else good? All right. Start on the coming events, if you would, please. And I need to let you know right after service tonight, if you are interested in helping out in any way during the missions conference, whether we have a lot of different things that we can use help with, as far as from the meals to the nightly gifts to getting things set up, getting things taken down, all kinds of things that we can plug in for. If you're interested in helping in any way, we're going to have a brief meeting down in the conference room after the service tonight. Okay, I'll say more about that at the end of the service, but we'll get you information, and then we'll let you know where we're going to plug you in for the missions conference if you'd like to help in that. All right. Remember, the cards are on the back table, the different needs of the missionaries. And if you haven't been there yet to see what the Lord would have you do there, just stop by the table after the service this evening, all right? Tomorrow night, of course, the RU Inside down at the CRC prison. Friday night is Reformers Unanimous here at the church. And Saturday morning, we're at London. And then, of course, our normal soul-winning visitation at 10 a.m. here at the church. And then be praying for the missions conference, which is September 17 through 20. All right. And remember, next Wednesday night, we'll start our children's programs for the fall. All right. So next Wednesday night, we'll kick those off on Wednesday evening. And so the kids will be happy about that. All right. If you go to the inside of your bulletin, We praise the Lord. 47 at CRC last Thursday, and 4 men received Christ as their Savior. And we had 13 Saturday morning at the London prison, and had a good meeting with those men there. We're glad to have Shane, who was baptized and into our fellowship on Sunday morning, and Michelle Manning become new members of the church. You could add a couple more there. If you look up underneath the sick there, both Amanda and Jackie got good news as far as the lumps that they had. And Jackie just told me before service they did her lymph node and no cancer at all. Everything's clear, and the same with Amanda. They both got good news this past week, so praise the Lord for that. All right, and continue to pray for the different ministries here and these on the list. If you add one to your list there for prayer, Margaret Talladay gave me this. Pray for the Tucker family. This is Sharon Talladay. That'd be their daughter-in-law. Her niece, Kim, was found dead this morning. And so she's going to be traveling there. Where is there? Arkansas, okay. She might be traveling there overnight to go to be with her family. And so pray for her safety on that trip. And certainly pray for the Tucker family, all right? This is it's a tragic thing, all right? And we want to certainly remember her in prayer, okay? Then, of course, we're praying for these in authority, praying for these serving our military. We're praying for these battling cancer. The one names on our list here, and then, of course, these for salvation, and the unreached people groups, our list for this week, that I hope you'll take time to pray for God to send forth laborers to reach these folks with the gospel, and then our missionaries, highlighted tonight by the Fitzsimmons in Haiti, and again, a good report from them and what the Lord's doing there. All right. Well, we want to go to prayer tonight. Brother Paul Abel, I'd like you to come, if you would, sir. And I'm going to have him lead us audibly in our prayer this evening. And, of course, as he prays audibly, we pray along with him silently and unite our hearts together in prayer. Don't let your mind wander off to something else. Just pray along with him as he leads us. Let's all pray together. All right, Brother John.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you tonight, and we thank you for the Word of God that you've written down and we can use in our daily lives, and then also taking it to the RU group and then also the children of the church here and the people that are here. We just thank you for the Word of God that never changes, and we thank you for the way we've seen things happen because the Word of God was preached to someone and they accepted with their heart and got saved. We thank you for that, and we thank you for the other outreaches here at the church, the nurseries, the nursery workers, and Sunday school workers, the bus workers, and then also we pray that you'd be with the missionaries that we have that go out into foreign countries, and we thank you for their service they give, that they are doing there, and we ask that you'd continue to bless the ministries there, and we do pray for the ministries we have here, all of them in the list there. We just thank you for those that you've blessed us with, and we pray that you'd continue to help us be able to do the best job that we possibly can. And then after that, you take over, and we thank you for that. We thank you for the offerings that come in here at the church and to do the things that need to be done. And we thank you for those that give, and we pray for those that cannot give, that you'll bless them also. We ask that you'd be with those that are on our sick list with cancer. We do pray that you'd continue to help those, and thank you for the two ladies that we heard of, the God healed them, and we thank you for the way that God just reaches in there and heals us perfectly, and that didn't have to do anything else, and we thank you for that. We thank you for the those that are on cancer list, and we pray that we continue to pray for them, that we'd see more of them come to get saved and get turned around in their life. And then we pray for those that are on our list that are not saved, but they're family members or friends, and we just pray that we see God reach down and touch people that would send them to the homes or whatever, however you want it done. We just pray that we'd be willing to follow you and serve you in this area. And then we do pray for you, our missionaries that are on stateside here, and we pray for them to help them get the support they need to get so they can get to the field, and we ask that you'd help them now, give them traveling mercies to and from, and we just pray that you'd be with our military that is out there watching over us tonight and protecting us. We thank you for the military that we have and those that have chosen to go in the military, that they give their time and body for us here at the state and stay at home. We ask that you'd help us now, and we pray that you'd be with the remainder of the service. We pray that you'd bless the pastor, giving him the words that you're exactly words you want him to give to us, and we pray that we'd be doers also as well as hearers of the word, and we pray that you'd help us now through this night. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, would you turn with me to 542 in your hymnal, 542. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word. Would you stand with me as we sing this together on that first? 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus said the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me neath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together.
To trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease, just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him more and more. Jesus, so glad I learned to trust thee. Precious Jesus, Savior, friend. Let's sing that last all together. I'm so glad I learned to
singing. You can be seated. Ushers will come and get our offering, and that's a good song to sing for an offering. Amen. Oh, for grace to trust him more. Amen. And we'll pray and ask God's blessing on our offering tonight, and I'll have Brother Wallace lead us in prayer this evening, if you would.
Let us pray. Father, thank you again for your love, your grace, your mercy. You're so good to us. Father, I want you to know that this is just an old sinner saved by grace. And Lord, the right that I now have to come to your throne room and, Lord, to ask for your help. Lord, we need to listen and pay attention to what is being said from your word tonight. Lord, we need the Holy Spirit to take control of our arms, our legs, our eyes, our ears, our mouth, that, Lord, we will pay total attention to what is from your word. Father, we just ask and beg for your mercy and your help. And Lord, we just ask that you bless the offering. May everything that is done and said here tonight be for your glory and your honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
My hands are hands and glory. Glory to the Son of God. As I entered the gates of that city, my loved ones all knew me well. They showed me all around heaven. The scenes were too numerous to tell. I saw Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Mark, Luke, and Timothy. But I said, I want to see Jesus, the one who died for me. Then I bowed on my knees and cried, holy, holy, holy. I clapped my hands and sang glory, glory to the Son of God. Then I bowed on my knees and cried, holy, holy, holy. I clapped my hands and sang glory, glory to the Son of God.
Thank you, Brett and Lisa. Take your Bible this evening, if you would, to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 6, please. Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians 6, and I'm going to read beginning verse 19. As for me, and for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, and therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. But that ye also may know my affairs and how I do, Tychicus, a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, shall make known to you all things, whom I have sent unto you for the same purpose, that ye might know our affairs, and that he might comfort your hearts. Peace be to the brethren, and love with faith, from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace be with all them that love our Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity. Amen. Father, add your blessing to the reading of our scripture here this evening. And Father, as we now open up the only book you've ever written, I'd ask that you'd open our understanding, and thy Holy Spirit would be the master teacher here this evening. And help us to glean tonight what you would have us to glean from not just this passage, but others that we'll turn to this evening. And Lord, I pray that each of us would desire to be faithful as these men that we'll look at this evening, and that you'll do a work in each of our hearts tonight that only you can do. And I simply ask that your will be accomplished as we bring forth your word this evening. Help me as I bring the study, and help the folks as they listen. In Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. You know, by all accounts, Edward Kimball was a very normal man. He worked a normal job and attended what would be considered probably a normal church. And he was a Sunday school teacher in that church. And as he was preparing his lessons one week, the Lord impressed upon his heart the importance of knowing that every boy in his class was a Christian. And so he set out to find out if every one of those boys were saved. And one day he happened upon a young man in his class named Dwight, who worked in a shoe shop. He was a clerk there. And he asked for permission to speak to this teenage boy, and was granted that permission. And he gave Dwight the gospel that day, and Dwight Moody accepted Christ as his Savior. Most of you have never heard of Edward Kimball, but you've heard of Dwight L. Moody. Well, in 1879, Moody, of course, became a great evangelist, and they say Dwight Moody had over 2 million people profess faith in Christ under his ministry. A million in here, and a million over in Europe, and greatly used of God. And while he was preaching, he touched the heart of a pastor at the time named F.B. Meyer, who was at that time just pastoring a small church. But he kindled in his heart an evangelistic fervor. And F.B. Meyer, while preaching on an American college campus, led to Christ a student there named J. Wilbur Chapman. J. Wilbur Chapman became an evangelist, and while he was engaged with the YMCA, which used to be a Christian organization, it isn't so much anymore. It's just, in fact, there's a push in most of the YMCAs now are just to do away with the MCA part, and they just want to be known as the Y. And my question is, why? But that's what they want. But back then, they were still involved in soul-saving work. And J. Wilbur Chapman employed a young man to help him in setting up his tents for his crusades. And that young man's name was Billy Sunday. And Billy Sunday would set up the tent and spread the sawdust on the ground and set up the chairs. And when he decided to go out into evangelism, his first 7 sermons came from J. Wilbur Chapman. And he was always afraid that they might ask him to have a continued meeting and go longer than 7 days, and he was scared to death because he only had 7 sermons. But Billy Sunday held a revival in Charlotte, North Carolina, and he touched the heart of some local people there that they planned another evangelistic campaign, and they brought a fellow in named Mordecai Ham. And during Mordecai Ham's revival, a young man surrendered to the gospel and gave his life to Christ, and that young man's name was Billy Graham. It's amazing how you go on. Some of those names you've heard of, the Billy Sundays or the Billy Grahams or some of those evangelists, but listen, there's very few here that might know the name of Edward Kimball, who just was a Sunday school teacher. But he started it all just by being faithful to find out if the boys in his class were saved. We know of the important and significant ones, so to speak, but without the Edward Kimballs, we don't know if those other folks would have ever done and been what they were for God. So many people wouldn't hear the wonderful word of God without the, quote, normal people, all right? And the Edward Kimballs, faithfully plugged in, behind the scenes, so to speak, out of the spotlight. They don't get a lot of attention. The attention likes to go to the evangelist. The attention likes to go to the pastor. The attention likes to go to the great, great singer. But God would shine the attention on those who were faithful behind the scenes and who really make the church go. Talking about nursery workers, diaper changers. Talking about chair putter-uppers and putter-downers and vacuum, you know, cleaner, running the vacuum cleaner and dusting things and cleaning things and just people who do the job day in and day out to fuel the church and make it go behind the scenes. Unsung volunteers. They're the soldiers. They're the privates in the army, so to speak. Years ago, I read about General Eisenhower, who once rebuked one of his generals for referring to a soldier as just a private. He reminded him that the army could function better without its generals than it could without its foot soldiers. He said, if the war is won, it will be won by the privates. And as the spiritual battle for souls of men is won, it'll be won by the privates. It'll not be won by the generals. And when we get into these epistles that we're going to talk about this evening, these 4 books that we're going to refer to tonight, they're called prison epistles. They're called prison epistles because they were written by Paul from prison in Rome. Now, an epistle is kind of a different word that you probably won't hear that word outside of church. Okay, and an epistle isn't a wife of an apostle. Okay, that's not who that is. An epistle is a word that simply means to send a message to. To send a message to. And so he's sending the message to these churches. and written by Paul while he's imprisoned in Rome. And he took these four letters to four different churches, and he entrusted them to faithful messengers to get them to the church. Four faithful messages. Four men that are not household names. I would say these four men we're going to talk about tonight, nobody here has named their children after these four guys. Okay? I don't think that you would do that. But they were chosen because of their trustworthiness, their faithfulness, their dedication to the Lord and to the Apostle Paul. And Paul entrusted their care four of the most important documents that have ever been written, because they were the words of God. And so these four messengers get to deliver it. I'm just going to look at these four messengers tonight, all right? The first one is who we read about in Ephesians chapter 6. We call him Tychicus. Tychicus. He's carrying the letter to the church at Ephesus. Now, he possibly, some people believe he might have eventually became a pastor at the church of Ephesus, but we don't know that for sure. He might have carried the letter to the Colossians as well. We don't know. But Tychicus is probably, we have the most information about him than we do any of the other three. And he's mentioned five times in the New Testament. And in Acts 20, in verse number 4, it says, there accompanied him, that's Paul, into Asia, Sopater of Berea, and of the Thessalonians, Aristarchus and Secundus and Gaius of Derbe, and Timotheus, and of Asia, Tychicus and Trophimus. He's mentioned again in Ephesians 6, as we just read, in verse number 21. He's mentioned in Colossians 4 and verse 7, 2 Timothy 4 and verse 12, and Titus 3 and verse 12. He was a Christian convert from Asia, and he was a friend and companion of the Apostle Paul. He was a faithful companion and a servant of Christ, and very, very influential in this church as a servant of the Lord. Now, probably if I ask the question, how many of you, before I mention that name, Tychicus, how many of you can honestly say I knew who that was? That's what I figured. Not really the household name. You probably never sat down at your dinner and said, let's consider Tychicus tonight. He's just not one of those household names. And probably when you're thinking of children's names, you don't think, what about Tychicus? That usually doesn't get into the discussion. Though someone did suggest to me today that Nikki, you and Andy, your girl, could be Ann, and then you'd have Andrew. And no, yeah, she's saying, yeah. Moving along. I suggested maybe Drusilla, but that didn't go over big either. I don't think so. You don't know him, but yet he faithfully carried out his duties that the Lord had given to him and that Paul was given to him. Four things about Tychicus I want to give to you. Number one, he was selfless. He was selfless. Paul calls him a beloved brother. A beloved brother. He wasn't out for recognition. He wasn't out to get top billing. He wasn't out to be known. He just was glad to be a brother in Christ. That's selfless. He was steadfast. He called him a faithful minister. A faithful minister of the Lord. Boy, I tell you what, if you're not faithful, you're not anything. How can you depend on something that's not faithful? There's not a person here that says, boy, I got a great car, you know, 4 out of 7 days, it works wonderful. If your car 4 out of 7 times you got in and it went somewhere, and 3 out of 7 times it didn't go anywhere, it was dead as a doornail, you'd say it's time for me to get either this car fixed or I need a different car. Why? This isn't dependable. This isn't faithful. And you got to be faithful. He was a faithful minister, steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Then he was serious. Paul said, he's a beloved brother, faithful minister, and whom, verse 22, I have sent unto you for the same purpose. He was serious about what he had to do. Paul said, he's serious enough, I can send him to do something, and I know he'll do it.
He's a worker that you didn't have to oversee what he was doing. Isn't it a great day when you can give a job to somebody and you don't have to go inspect it and don't have to stay there and make sure they're doing it? But you can tell them, hey, take care of this, and you can go away and know when I come back, it's going to be taken care of. Paul did that with Tychicus. He was serious about the work of God. And then he was also sensitive because he says he might know our affairs and that he might comfort your hearts. He's going to comfort you. He's going to be an encouragement to you. He's going to be sensitive. And it's interesting, he didn't call him a friend. He called him a brother. Proverbs 17 and verse 17 says, a friend loves at all time. Love at all times. And a brother is born for adversity. A brother is born for adversity. Brothers, and I'd say sisters, are in our lives for adversity. They're in our lives when things get tough. When things go south, as they say. I'm not sure how the South got the rap on that, but situations overwhelm us, and you say, well, you know, sometimes you have families, but you know, sometimes families that are outside of Christ, they don't understand. And they're not a great comfort. And they won't give you the best advice because they won't give you biblical advice. And even, by the way, even Jesus had some early tension in his family. They didn't understand. Remember when they thought he was crazy, they got his brothers and his sisters over there and said, you got to come get him. He's gone. He's mad. And I don't mean angry. They mean he's nutso. And you got to help him out here. And so there was some tension there, I'm sure. But you know what you ought to be able to count on? You ought to be able to count on a brother or a sister in Christ in adversity. We're not just, listen, we're born, a brother or a sister is born for adversity. We're here to help one another when you go through a hard time. One of the most difficult things that you experience as you go through pastoring for 30 years is that I watch people when they start to go through a hard time draw back and want to stay away from everybody instead of allow folks to help them and surround them and support them. That's what a brother and sister in Christ is for. We're here to support one another in adversities, in difficulties, in setbacks. And so we need a lot of people like Tychicus in the church. Amen? Selfless, steadfast, serious, and sensitive. That's Tychicus. Maybe you could be a Tychicus. Now, the second guy, his name is Epaphroditus. Almost sounds like a disease, doesn't it? Epaphroditus. You say, oh, I had that once, but I got medicine for it. But Epaphroditus, he carried Paul's letter to the Philippines. Yeah, to Philippi, the church at Philippi, the book of Philippians. Now, Epaphroditus may have been the pastor of the church in Philippi, but they did send him with a gift to aid Paul when he was in prison. And now Paul sends him back to Philippi with the letter to the church. Epaphroditus, the Bible says, devoted himself to the work of Christ as a helper to Paul, an assistant, if you will, to Paul, as well as being involved in the missionary work. Now the Bible says, in fact, look at Philippians chapter 2, would you please? The Bible says Epaphroditus worked himself so hard and drove himself to do, he literally lost his health because of how hard he worked for Christ. And so when Paul sent back this letter, the Spirit of God had him write this. Look at verse 25 of Philippians chapter 2. Yet I suppose it necessary to send unto you Epaphroditus, my brother and companion in labor and fellow soldier, but your messenger and he that ministered to my wants. For he longed after you all and was full of heaviness because that ye had heard he had been sick. For indeed he was sick, nigh unto death, but God had mercy on him, and not on him only, but on me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. Let me just pause here to say, if you recall, there were times that Paul could heal folks during a time when that could take place. Why didn't Paul just lay hands on them and heal them? Why didn't he just take him to a Benny Hinn crusade? And didn't do it. You know how he got healed? God had mercy on him. How many of you in this room ever been sick? Okay. How many are not sick tonight? Okay. Guess what happened? God healed you. Why? He had mercy on you. And God will have mercy on whom will have mercy, and that's up to God. It's God who brings healing, not individuals, not people. God is the healer. And so he healed here Epaphroditus. Now, verse 28, I sent him therefore the more carefully, that when ye see him again, ye may rejoice, and that I may be the less sorrowful. Receive him therefore in the Lord with all gladness, and hold such in reputation. Because for the work of Christ, he was nigh unto death, not regarding his life, to supply your lack of service toward me. Boy, it was a point where Paul really admonishes them to, and really thanks him for his devotion to the cause of Christ, and the fact he was so devoted. And it brings up a difficult aspect here about serving God, and that is, when you want to serve God, but you hit some circumstances that are out of your control. Your uncontrollable circumstances. Your heart's in the right place, but your circumstances come and the door seems to shut. And you can't do what you thought it was in your heart to do. And that happens. And that happened here to Epaphroditus. I think he was sent off to serve with Paul from the church here. And he brought the gift, and he ministered with Paul and served with Paul. But now he got sick where he almost died, and God has brought him back to health. But Paul doesn't want him to stay there. He says, you got to go back home. They need you there, and you need to return back home. It probably wasn't the easiest thing for Epaphroditus to do. He had been sent off by the church to go help Paul and minister to Paul. And because of health reasons, he's got to come back home. That's a hard thing to do. But it wasn't in his control. It was in God's control. But it was out of his control. And so you have to understand that wasn't an easy thing to do. And that was difficult. And so he tells the church, encourage him when he comes home. Make sure that you hold him in reputation. That means you hold him in honor. Now notice what he calls him. Paul calls him my brother, my fellow worker, and my fellow soldier. And the three terms are used, and I think in the proper order. First, he says my brother. That means we share a common faith. When Saul got saved, and God instructed Ananias to greet him, and that he was going to baptize him. Well, the first thing he said when he saw Saul was, he called him Brother Saul. Now, how did he get to be a brother? Well, he met Jesus on the road to Damascus. He received him as a Savior. When you come into the doors of the church, if you know Christ as your Savior, hey, you may be CEO somebody out there, or vice president somebody out there, but when you come in here, you're brother. We're brothers and sisters in Christ. We don't have titles. Yeah, you're just a brother. We share a common faith. Amen? We share a common faith. And so that's what Epaphroditus had. Then he called him my fellow worker, because they're involved in a common work. We are saved to serve. We are saved to serve. But we quoted those verses earlier. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. That next verse says, for ye are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. Created in Christ Jesus. You were created in Christ Jesus when you were born again. If a man be in Christ, he is a new creature. You're created in Christ Jesus unto what? Good works. Not to sit and soak and sour, but to serve. You're here to serve. And so Paul said, hey, he's a fellow worker. Man, everybody ought to be working for Jesus Christ. There's something that you can do for Christ. And so work for him. And so he says, he's my brother. He's a fellow worker. But then he called him a fellow soldier. Why is that? Because they shared a common danger. Being a soldier is a dangerous a dangerous occupation. You know why? There's casualties. Why? We're in a war. You say, "President, we're in a war?" Yeah, we're in a war. We're in a spiritual warfare. We talked a little bit about that Sunday evening. Oh, it's listen, we're wrestling not against flesh and blood. What is that? Principalities and powers. We have an enemy, and the enemy is the devil, and we are at war. And so you have to realize you're a soldier. Whether you're new, you're in the army or not, you're in the army. When you received Christ, your Savior, you were enlisted into the army of God. And you're all in the army if you know Christ as your Savior. So he told the church to receive Epaphroditus, receive him with joy, and to hold him in reputation or hold him in great honor because of his service for the Lord. And there's nothing wrong with honoring people who faithfully serve the Lord. Nothing wrong with doing that. And we should. So we have Tychicus, and then we have Epaphroditus. By the way, how many know somebody named Epaphroditus? I didn't think so. That's your middle name, Nathaniel? Nathaniel Epaphroditus Anderson? Is that right? All right. The third fella we come to is Epaphras. Not Epaphroditus, but Epaphras. He brought the letter to the church in Colossae. Now, Epaphras was with Paul during part of his first imprisonment in Rome. And Epaphras was not just a messenger to the church, but he was a missionary through which the people in Colossae had come to know Christ. Look at Colossians chapter 1, would you please? Verse number 7. As ye also learned of Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who is for you a faithful minister of Christ, who also declared unto us your love in the Spirit. Epaphras had a hand in bringing some of these folks to Christ, but not only them. You find out that he probably had a hand in the church at Laodicea, which was not far from Colossae, and also a church that was in Hierapolis. And while there's some people believe Onesimus might have carried the letter to the church at Colossae, or maybe Tychicus did, I think Epaphras took seriously the admonition to take the gospel to every creature and certainly to every region. And he had a great impact on this area for Jesus Christ. He did a tremendous work. And it's interesting that nobody remembers his name. He had a great impact in starting the church at Colossae, helping get the people saved in Laodicea and in Hierapolis, at least three churches that we know of in that area. And yet most people have said, when's the last time you had a discussion about Epaphras? And most of you never heard his name till tonight. Isn't that amazing? Because we talk about the generals, we don't talk much about the privates. But the privates get the work done. They get the job done. And so it was Epaphras that had brought to Paul the good news of the progress of the church in Colossae and what God was doing in their midst. And so Paul, in turn, calls Epaphras a dear fellow servant and a faithful minister of Christ. Now later on, in Colossians chapter 4 and verse 12, he refers to him as a servant of Christ. A servant of Jesus Christ. And that's a term there that Paul only ever used for himself. He never used that term for anybody else except Epaphras. He called him a servant of Jesus Christ. And so he's and by the way, Jesus taught his disciples that the greatest among you will be your servant. And these are great men. Four great messengers. First guy was Tychicus. Can you say that? Tychicus. All right. If not, fake it. All right. Tychicus. All right. The second guy was Epaphroditus. The third guy is Epaphras. The fourth guy is Onesimus. Onesimus. Now, if you go past Colossians, and go past 1st, 2nd Thessalonians, and go past 1st, 2nd Timothy, and go past Titus. Those are the letters to his preacher boys. Now you find a little book right before Hebrews called Philemon. Philemon. This is a letter that Paul writes to an individual named Philemon. Philemon was a wealthy citizen of Colossae and a prominent member of the church in Colossae. All right? Onesimus had been a slave working for Philemon. And he had done something wrong, whether he'd stolen something, defrauded him, but he had done something that he felt like he couldn't stay, he had to run away. And he ran away to the big city of Rome to try to hide among the crowd, I'm sure. And the fella, now whether it's pretty unclear whether he how he got to know Paul or whether he got caught in prison there and whatever it was, but somehow he had conversation with Paul, and Paul led him to faith in Christ. And then Paul begins to inquire about where he came from and what he's doing in Rome and what the deal is, and Onesimus begins to unfold the story for him, and Paul begins to realize, I know Philemon. What a coincidence. You go into the city with thousands or hundreds of thousands of people, and God leads you to one person who knows the guy that you ran away from. That's pretty incredible. And so he pins a letter back to Philemon about Onesimus. And this is the letter we have right here. Look at it, will you? Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ, and Timothy, our brother, unto Philemon, our dearly beloved and fellow laborer, and to our beloved Apphia and Archippus, our fellow soldier in the church in thy house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God, making mention of thee always in my prayers, hearing of thy love and faith which thou hast toward the Lord Jesus and toward all saints, that the communication of thy faith may become effectual by the acknowledging of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. For we have great joy and consolation in thy love, because the bowels of the saints are refreshed by thee, brother. Wherefore, though I might be much bold in Christ to enjoin thee that which is convenient, yet for love's sake I rather beseech thee, being such a one as Paul the aged, and now also a prisoner of Jesus Christ. I beseech thee for my son Onesimus, whom I have begotten in my bonds. Means he's been born again. Now listen, which in time past was to thee unprofitable, but now profitable to thee and to me, whom I have sent again. Thou therefore receive him, that is, mine own bowels, whom I would have retained with me, that in thy stead he might have ministered unto me in the bonds of the gospel. But without thy mind would I do nothing, that thy benefit should not be as it were of necessity, but willingly. For perhaps he therefore departed for a season, that thou shouldest receive him forever. Now not as a servant, but above a servant, a brother, beloved, specially to me, but how much more unto thee, both in the flesh and in the Lord. If thou count me therefore a partner, receive him as myself. If he hath wronged thee or oweth thee aught, put that on mine account. I, Paul, have written it with mine own hand. I will repay it, albeit I do not say thee how thou owest unto me even thine own self besides. Yea, brother, let me have joy of thee in the Lord. Refresh my bowels in the Lord. Having confidence in thy obedience, I wrote unto thee, knowing that thou wilt also do more than I say. But withal prepare for me also a lodging, for I trust that through your prayers I shall be given unto you. There salute thee Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, and Marcus and Aristarchus, Demas, Lucas, my fellow laborers. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen. I don't know that Onesimus knew the content of the letter he's carrying. We don't know if he knew what was even inside, that he's heading back home. But here he is, having fled as a fugitive and having fled as a thief, and now he has to come back home, which meant death. But he comes back home holding that letter, believing what Paul has told him, that if he gives this letter to Philemon, he won't die. That's pretty amazing. And he faithfully does it. That's pretty incredible. I wonder if he ever thought, maybe I ought not go back. What would ever happen to Philemon? What would ever happen to this book that we have in the Bible? But he went back home, carrying with him the most valuable piece of paper he could ever possess. Paul urged a change in his status. He calls Onesimus his brother. He leaves as a runaway slave, and he's sent back not as a slave, but as a brother. A brother in Christ. One who is dear to the heart of Paul. Listen. Thank God for the life-changing power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Don't ever underestimate the power of the gospel to change your life. Man, if that power can raise up Christ from the dead, that power can take away all of our sins, that power can change your life. No Christian has to live under the power of sin, because there's a greater power than the power of sin. And allow Christ and the power of the gospel to change your life. Look what it did for Paul. Look at the drastic change that took place. Listen, don't ever settle for the fact, well, my family's always been this way, or my dad was this way, or my grandpa's this way, and that's just the way our family is. Well, where's the power of Christ in that? Where's the power of the gospel to change in your life? Or do you have it as an out that, well, that's just the way my family is? And so you just continue to allow things in your life that ought not to be there as a believer. And you don't allow Christ and His power to change your life. He was a completely different person. So we have four messengers: Tychicus, Epaphras, and Onesimus. Four great letters, four different destinations. The prison epistles, as they're called. They cover all aspects of the Christian life. They cover the entire area. If you read all of them together, and you can, you'll find Ephesians, and we were there Sunday evening. Ephesians is very a lot of doctrinal foundation in the first four chapters. As you get into 5 and 6, it gets real practical on how you live out your faith in your life and in your relationships. Remember, the relationship between a husband and a wife, and relationship to God, relationship to the Holy Spirit, relationship to your children. We went through those relationships on Sunday night. Philippians talks about your heart. Philippians talks about your motives and your attitudes. It talks about having joy. Tell him the joy that he had, even though he was in prison, even though he was in chains. Because joy is that cheerful, calm delight in any particular circumstance. No matter what the circumstance is, you just have a cheerful, calm delight, because joy has nothing to do with what's outside of you. Joy has everything to do with what's inside of you. And so you have joy because of what's on the inside. And who's on the inside? Jesus Christ is on the inside. He gives you the joy no matter what the circumstances are. Sometimes people look and say, man, what? How can you be joyful? Man, if I was going through what you're going through, I'd be freaking out. I'd be a basket case. You tell them, oh, it's not what, it's who I've got inside. It makes a difference. And I can have that cheerful, calm delight. You go to Colossians, and it directs our attention to Christ. He's the head of the church. Christ is the theme. Colossians tells us in all things, He is to have the preeminence. He's the center of the circle around which the Christian life revolves. It's Christ. And when you come to church, you ought to see Christ lifted up. Every morning, listen, the first one you think of in the morning is Christ. First one you talk to in the morning is Christ. Last one you talk to when you go to bed at night ought to be Christ. And everything in between revolves around Christ. That's Colossians. And then Philemon. Christianity in action. This is where the rubber meets the road, so to speak. One thing the world doesn't understand quite about believers, and that is the power of forgiveness in a believer's life. What do believers do? You know what we do? We forgive one another. We don't point fingers at each other because we know that there's not one of us that is without sin. There isn't one of us that hasn't been forgiven by God. How can we not forgive somebody else? In fact, the Lord said, if you don't forgive others their trespasses, your Father in heaven won't forgive you your trespasses. I don't know about you, but I can't afford that. So we offer forgiveness, and the world scratches their head. Say, how can she forgive him? How can he forgive her? How can they forgive? They don't understand that. They want to pound the flesh. And sometimes we're not careful, we get that way too. We want somebody to pay for what they've done wrong. No, last I checked, Jesus paid it all. He paid for all our sin debt. And so we get to live it out with the forgiveness. So these four messengers carried out that vital information, the Word of God, to their respective destinations. You ever think about how, I thought, Brother Ron, I thought about the people who get their first Bible. Can you imagine what it must have been like for the church when these fellows showed up and they had the letter? And they said, read it. Read it to us. No, 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 we'll wait till Sunday. No! Now, let's have service tonight. Read it. How excited they must have been to get the Word of God. Excited they were that it was an epistle to them. Wow. But isn't that what God's given to us? How's our excitement for God's Word? How's our eagerness to open the letter? And to read what God's given to us. We treat it with the same zeal and enthusiasm that they would have greeted the letters with. How's our enthusiasm for the Word of God? I thank God for those messengers. Oh, we know Paul, and there's plenty of people you might know named Paul. We name them after him. But I thank God for Tychicus, for Epaphroditus, for Epaphras, and for Onesimus. Four foot soldiers, without which we may not have that. Thank God for their faithfulness. Sometimes you sit and say, man, I don't know if I could be Paul. I couldn't be Peter. Yeah, but could you be a Tychicus? Could you be an Epaphras? Could you be an Epaphroditus? Can you beat Onesimus? Onesimus, oh, you don't know about my past. You don't know about Onesimus' past. But he's in the book as a faithful servant of God. Don't talk about where you've been. Talk about where you are and talk about where you're going. The Bible says you run your race. You don't run your race looking in the rearview mirror. You run your race looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Amen? Set your sight on being a faithful messenger of Jesus Christ. Let's stand together, shall we? Heavenly Father, take the truth now this evening. Thank you, Lord, for these four men that we've spent time studying tonight. Lord, men who I'm sure at the time had no idea that nearly 2,000 years later, we're talking about them. And we're looking at their lives. We're challenged and we're encouraged, we're blessed by their faithfulness to you, by their service for you. Lord, I thank you for these men, and I thank you for the faithful servants that you have given to us at Bible Baptist Church. People who work behind the scenes and people who do the things that are necessary every week to fuel the work of God here. That are never in the spotlight, but they faithfully carry out what you've called them to do. Thank you for them. And may you help each of us to desire to be faithful messengers of Jesus Christ. And may we be faithful until you come for us. Now, Father, dismiss us with your care tonight. Make us mindful you go with us from this place. Help us to please you in all we do. And I ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. All right, we're going to sing together. Isn't he wonderful, wonderful? While we're doing this, choir members, I want you to make your way to the choir, all right? You're going to have just a real quick practice. Hold on a second. You're going to have a real quick practice. And then those of you who want to help with the missions conference, you come down and join in the meeting in the conference room, okay? The rest of you can fellowship a little bit and then head that way, and then we can all meet together. But I don't want people in the choir to miss out if they want to help out in the missions conference, okay? You got the plan? That's the plan. Let's work the plan, all right? You move while we sing. Isn't he wonderful? Now, Lisa. All right, let's sing. Isn't he wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard, it's recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? One more time, all right? Isn't he wonderful? Sing it. That's it. Eyes have seen, ears have heard, it's recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? God bless you. You're dismissed.